Hi, I'm Ned, and I make games. In this video in my MIPMAP series, I'd like to introduce the partial derivative functions ddx, ddy, and fwidth. Although they're used behind the scenes to choose which MIPMAP level to render, they have many other applications, which I'm going to focus on today. You might have heard about partial derivatives from calculus, but these shader functions are only conceptually related, so no calc is required here. They basically return how much a value changes between pixels on the screen. The ddx and ddy functions find how much a variable changes when moving one pixel to the right and one pixel up, respectively. For instance, pass world position into a ddx node and get how much the world position changes when moving one pixel to the right. Pass uv into a ddy node and get how much that value changes moving one pixel up. You can pass basically any variable into these nodes and get a valid result. Which seems kind of magical. How does it work? There's a stage in the rendering process called the fragment stage, where the shader computes what colors to place on the screen. You can usually think of a fragment function running once per pixel on the screen, but the GPU actually runs four fragment functions in parallel, making up a 2x2 pixel square. These functions all run in lockstep, so they're executing the same code at the same time. This means that the renderer knows the value of all variables inside these four fragment functions at all times, each working on adjacent pixels. When you call a partial derivative function, the renderer compares the passed variable's value on two adjacent pixels. DDX returns the left pixel's value subtracted from the rights, and DDY returns the top pixel's value subtracted from the bottoms. Keep in mind that these functions are only available during the fragment stage. Try to hook one up to a vertex stage node in the shader graph, and it won't even let you. This is a good time to mention the DDX and DDY shader graph nodes. Of course, when writing in HLSL, the DDX and DDY functions are also available for use. In the intro, I mentioned another derivative function, fwidth. Fwidth is kind of like a combined DDX and DDY that takes the length of a vector comprising them. Fwidth is actually an approximation. Instead of resorting to the Pythagorean theorem, it just takes the absolute value of each partial and adds them together. That's usually good enough for such small values. Fwidth is available in HLSL natively. Unfortunately, there's not an fwidth node in the shader graph, but you can access it with a custom function. Instead, the shader graph provides a ddxy node, which skips the absolute value step and simply adds ddx and ddy together. Okay, so that's the nitty-gritty behind these partial derivative functions, but what are they good for? The biggest use is to pick a MIPMAP level, but that happens automatically when sampling a texture. Let's look at some effects that you can create yourself. One cool use is to reconstruct triangle or face normals and make a flat-shaded shader. Usually the normal vector contained in vertices is averaged across all connected faces, making for a smooth lighting curve. If you need normals pointing directly outwards from a face, take the partial derivatives of position and compute their cross product. This returns a vector perpendicular to the partial derivatives, which are both pointing along a mesh's face. Usefully, the normal will be in the same space as position, so you can use this to get normals in world space or view space. Note that these normals won't be super high quality, but they should do in many situations. You can also use partial derivatives to cheaply anti-alias procedural shader patterns. This simple shader draws a different color depending on if the UVU coordinate is greater than a threshold. If you zoom in, you can see the jagged edges. To fix this, pass the UV to fwidth. This will give you the approximate UV change over a pixel, with which to construct bounds on either side of the threshold. All that's left to do is blend the colors based on where the UV lies between those bounds, which an inverse interpolate and saturate node can calculate. With all that done, the edge becomes much smoother. You can use this for a nice and crisp toon shader. Or for procedural shapes, like this spiral. keep in mind that this type of anti-aliasing is not as high quality as, say, multi-sample anti-aliasing, but it's quite a lot faster. And that's about it for the DDX, DDY, and FWidth functions. I hope you enjoyed this little tangent. In the next video, I'll go deeper into mipmaps once again, seeing how these functions drive the mipmap choice algorithm. Thanks so much for watching. If you like game development, consider subscribing. I post weekly content here, and I'm working on a big series on grass rendering. If you like this tutorial, I'd really appreciate it if you could click the like button. It encourages YouTube to recommend the video to others, and it really helps me out. I also want to thank my patrons for their support, and give a big shout out to David Crew, my next gen patron. Thank you all so much. If you're not already a patron and interested in viewing videos early, downloading project files, or voting on future tutorial topics, consider joining my Patreon. But don't feel pressured, I really appreciate you watching the videos at all. Thanks again for watching, and make games.